After we did that DNA history, writing the history of DNA with citation data, we always talked about the idea of being able to do that in a kind of a automatic or semi-automatic, algorithmic fashion. And about 5 years ago, I was talking to Sasha Pudovkin about that project, and I don't remember the exact sequence. He probably remembers it better than I do. We decided, well, why don't we now try it? Because things have changed. We've got the computer power and so forth. And so we began to do the programs for doing that. And as a result of that work, and then we brought in Vladimir Istomin is his former student from Siberia, who was at the University of Washington State University at the time. So he started to do the programming. He knows Perl and other programming lines. Very clever programmer. And that's how we got into his site, doing these algorithmic historiographic analyses. And the software is now going to be available, I believe, next week is the launch. Next week or two. Because they've done the final touches on, you know, whatever they have to do for a commercial program. And I think ISI is going to help with the marketing of it. So we'll see where that goes. But basically, people are going to have to learn a little bit about modulating that kind of information, because it doesn't work out as simply as you'd like. Some of the things are very straightforward. I mean, you just do a typical search of a subject. Like, you don't have to do a complete subject. You just do, let's say, download 1,000 references from WAS, and you identify right away that sample, the 50 most important papers in the field based on the frequency analysis and so forth. And you get a nice looking little map, depending on how complex the field is. But some of the times you think you're going to be able to prove a point and it doesn't work out quite as well, because there's this variation in the way people cite the literature that doesn't always show you know, the microlinks. I think in a macro sense it works perfectly well, because the citation frequencies are so large that it doesn't matter whether you make small mistakes in the, mm-hmm. But if you got something that was linked by one or two references, you could easily lose it. And if you want to display more than 200 nodes at a time, it gets to be difficult on that limited screen. That's why I mentioned that huge screen. We can, if you get a huge big screen, then you can do a lot more with it and see some of the connections that you would otherwise miss, Because whenever I go back and try to trace the history of something, I learn something new every time I look in the file. And it turns out that what the software now does, in comparison to what it first did, we used to separate what we called inner and outer references. Uh-huh. Now it just generates one complete citation index for the file right away. And you can separate them. You can either have both or all. And then you get a timeline right away as a timeline of the subject. Because depending, what happens is, if you get enough people who've written on a subject, collectively they produce a pretty comprehensive history of the field. I mean, it's all there. If these people aren't going to give you the information, who will? it's sort of like a given thing, unless you're going into some obscure subject that nobody's ever really written about. In that case, you wouldn't find any references anyhow. So I think that would have proved to be of interest to a lot of people when it gets to be more widely used. But I've always encountered resistance to this sort of thing by trained historians. They don't trust that stuff. It's got to be subjective. The old-fashioned way of doing it. You gotta read it all first, and then you produce the analysis. It's like when I was at the Welsh Medical Library, I used to go to the lectures for Oswald Temkin, very famous historian of medicine, who was located there. And at one time, somebody went to one of his lectures and asked a question which involved making implicitly the answer that Temkin gave was, the answer to your question is, if it was there, I would have read it. He'd read everything ever written on that subject in any language you could think of, including, you know, six or seven languages. That's not the way it is today. I don't know whether that would have been true for Henry Sigrist and others like him or Needham or whatever. But now, Bob Merton was the kind of a guy that, you know, read a lot. His recollection was incredible too, memory. So anyhow, it would hope that ultimately, when all this stuff gets put up on the web and it's all, you know, the books and everything else is completely digital, we'll be able to get some very interesting historical analyses. But I guess we're going to have to modify all the different softwares to take advantage of all the full text that'll be available. Because right now we're dependent on databases like WAS or Scopus or Google or whatever. But when you do the full text, you're going to have different software written to take advantage of all that stuff and then do your mapping. So there's a lot more to be done yet.